This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do.
All you want to do is ride around Saturday.
Ride, Saturday.
You know, one thing that I have observed over my many years in the horse industry is that if you've got a horse, you probably also have one or more dogs. Hi, everybody. Rick Lamb here for the Horse Show. Horse lovers or dog lovers, that's almost a given. And so every once in a while, we kind of take a little left turn here on the Horse Show and talk about dogs. And the first time I did it, actually, was a great dog trainer that was at an expo, a rural agricultural expo I went to. His name's Jack Knox, and he's a very famous trainer of herding dogs. And I put him on television, and I thought, well, is my audience going to be kind of upset because we're not talking about horses? I got so much response to that, all good, because, you know, horse people are not one-dimensional. They have other things in their lives, and dogs are usually very important to them as well. I say all of that because my guest today made his name in association with an adorable little dog that kind of won the hearts of everybody in America. The dog's name was Benji, and Benji was the subject of a movie many years ago now, and his creator, the guy who trained him, and not the guy that created the dog, the guy who created the story and trained the dog and made this all happen, produced the movie outside the machinery usually used in Hollywood, completely independently, was a gentleman by the name of Joe Kemp. Now, Joe came on my radar a few years ago because he got very interested in horses, and with the same kind of obsession that he brought to the task of dog training and his riding, which is marvelous, he jumped into this business of trying to figure out horses and try and understand the psychology of them and create a lifestyle, a context for them to live in domestication that actually worked for them, that was good for them, that fit them as a species. And he's done a wonderful job, especially considering how relatively few years he has been involved with horses. He wrote a book several years ago. It came out the same year that my book, Human to Horseman, did, 2008, called The Soul of a Horse, Life Lessons from the Herd. And I got an advanced copy of this before I'd actually even met Joe and read it. And I just thought it was marvelous. And I ended up giving him a quote that he could use on it. And I recommend it to everybody. It's been a tremendous success for him. And it has spawned other things that he writes now, a blog and other books and so forth. So it's always a pleasure to air for you again this interview, my first time meeting Mr. Joe Kemp of Benji fame and author of Soul of a Horse. Towards the end of our show today, you're going to meet Julie Goodnight. If you don't already know her, she's known to practically everybody from her television show on RFD-TV. She's going to talk a little bit about that, her approach to horsemanship, and the Certified Horsemanship Association, which is a way that you can find a teacher that's appropriate to you. I always say that's so important that you get a teacher of horsemanship that fits you. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show, and we'll be back. Stay with us. EPM is a devastating neurologic disease that can strike anytime, anywhere. Be prepared with Protozil, the only FDA-approved top-dress EPM treatment. These alfalfa-based pellets are proven to rapidly reach therapeutic levels and are a less stressful option for you and your horse than a paste. For a limited time only, Merck Animal Health is offering a $50 Protozil rebate with proof of purchase from your veterinarian. To download the rebate, visit Protozil.com. That's Protazil.com. See website for complete product safety information. Jeffers is the best equine catalog with more than 25,000 items, same-day free shipping, and the lowest prices guaranteed. Jeffers has equine blankets in a wide range of sizes and weights to fit any horse from a mini to a draft. Mention the Horse Show and get a $10 Jeffers gift card to use with a future order. That's a $10 gift card when you buy a blanket and mention the Horse Show. Call 1-800-JEFFERS or visit jefferseequine.com. Jeffers Equine, earning your trust right here in America since 1975.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
As you can imagine, I get inundated with horse magazines and books every single month. I always make time to read Horse and Rider. It is the how-to magazine for Western riding. Wouldn't do without it. Call 1-800-829-3340 and say Rick Lamb sent you.
Red Brand Fence welcomes you to visit our new online store called redbrandstore.com. There you can purchase Red Brand Fence, installation tools, and a wide selection of Red Brand clothing and accessories. Ordering is easy, and items are shipped directly to your home, including fence. There's also special offers and seasonal promotions. And for a limited time, listeners of The Horse Show can receive 10% off your first order of fence, clothing, or tools. To receive your discount, go to redbrandstore.com and enter promo code HORSESHOW10.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition. Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need. Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's growstrong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Imagine this, your stirrup drops 3 inches with the push of a button and locks back in place with the lift of your toe. That, my friends, is the legendary Easy Up Stirrup Extender, and it makes a huge difference in mounting your horse. Learn all about it at easyupstirrup.com, and while you're there, check out the Easy Up Stirrup Swivel. It takes the stress off your knees while riding. Easy Up Stirrup Extenders and Stirrup Swivels are available for English and Western saddles, and you can order them online at easyupstirrup.com. Come on, get out and ride again.
Now, back to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
Hey, welcome back, everybody. Coming to you today from the Rocky Mountain Horse Expo in Denver, Colorado. My guest for this segment of The Horse Show Live is my dear friend, Julie Goodnight. Julie, great to see you again.
Same to you, Rick.
We get to see you now on TV as well as at events like this.
Yeah,
congratulations.
You bet. Every week.
Tell us a little bit about your TV show.
Well, we've really had a lot of fun with the show. It's called Horse Master with Julie Goodnight. It airs weekly. Wednesdays at 5:30 Eastern, and it's a show about regular horse people and regular horses that have issues or things they want to improve on, and I come in and help them out with their issues, help define the issues, sort out the horse, teach the rider something new, and then hopefully by the end of the show we've got them off on a better foot.
And this is all on RFD TV.
That's right.
Is there any other? There? No, of course not. That is how people interested in horses in this day and age get so much good information. How do you find the people, and I started to say problem horses, but I've tried to quit using that term.
Yes, and you know, as you and I both know, it's 99% of horse problems are rider-induced. So we prefer to refer to them as issues.
Issues.
And they don't really have to be problems or issues. Sometimes our episodes are about someone just improving themselves, moving up to the next level. Like we did a high-level rider, dressage rider, who wanted to improve her ability to collect the horse. So that was a show on collection. But we find the riders, we travel around the country for our filming. We film 6 episodes at a time in various parts of the country, and people can go to our website, it's horsemaster.tv, and they can apply to be on the show.
I've never asked you this, and I hate to put you on the spot. Have you ever run into a horse rider issue that you could not help in some way?
Well, we have turned people down for the show because of that. When I get an issue where I believe that the horse is inappropriate for the owner, I'm not going to do an episode on that when all I can honestly say is this is not the right horse for you. So we are looking for issues that we can actually resolve. But when I feel that there's an inappropriateness to let's say a novice person has a horse with a, you know, that's been severely abused or has some serious issues, or an untrained horse that they're trying to ride, if I don't believe it's appropriate, we just don't accept them on the show.
Well, and that very topic you spoke on so well in a TV interview that you did with me before your TV show launched, and I got so much response on that, and it was like, you know, this huge outburst of gratefulness of somebody being willing to stand up and say that you can't always fix the issue that exists between a human and a horse, because sometimes it's just such a horrible mismatch. And life is too short.
Yes, life is too short. And I've gotten and continue to get a huge amount of feedback from that interview at expos I go to. Every one this year, people have commented on that, even though it was some time ago that it ran. And I think it struck a chord with a lot of people because it gave them permission.
You got it.
To say to themselves, you know, maybe this isn't the right horse for me, and life is too short, and I need to move on. This horse isn't happy with me, I'm not happy with him, and we can both be better off in the right situation.
See, that I think is the magic ingredient there, is that it's a way not of giving up on a horse and just abandoning him to whatever happens, but actually giving him a chance for a better life with somebody that
yes.
could offer him what he needs.
Yes.
I think once you made that clear, that truly did give people permission. And just in terms of TV shows, that was probably the least complicated show we did all year. There was no supporting video to cut in and all. It was just you and I chatting, and I think that it was so popular is a testament to how well you spoke on that subject.
Well, thank
you. I want to talk about something a little bit different today, something you're very actively involved in. It's the Certified Horsemanship Association. And let's just start at the beginning. What is it?
Well, CHA is a nonprofit organization. We were formed in 1967, so we're 41 years old this year. And I've been involved with the organization since 1998. Well, actually, I've been working with the organization since 98. I actually became a certified instructor in 1995, and I was certified as a master instructor and clinician. And the mission of CHA is to promote safety and excellence in horsemanship. So we are primarily a safety-based organization. And the major things that we do in order to promote safety and excellence is to certify riding instructors. We also certify trail guides. We have a certification program for instructors of riders with disabilities, vaulting coaches. We're getting ready to start a new program on for driving instructors and commercial carriage drivers. Yeah, so we're broad-based, and we certify instructors. It's a hands-on certification program. So you come for a 5-day clinic, you take a written test, you take a riding test, and then you show over 3 or 4 days your ability to teach lessons. So it's very hands-on. We know what we see by the end of the clinic, and people get certified at the end of the clinic according to the level that they've been able to demonstrate their proficiency.
Do you know off the top of your head about how many certified instructors there are in the country?
Yes, we maintain about 4,000 instructors
wow.
in our database. We're very prominent in Canada as well. So I would, just a guess, I would say probably that would break down to maybe 2,500 or 3,000 in the U.S. and the remainder in Canada. We have a few odds and end countries too, but most of our instructors are in Canada and the U.S.
So is the idea that the public would just go to one of these websites and like put in their zip code or something and find a
yes,
certified instructor near them?
We have a website called chainstructors.com, and it is our directory of instructors and also accredited facilities. And you can go in and search by state, you can search by name, those sorts of things. Pretty easy to come up with a list of instructors in your area.
Wow, what a great idea. I'm talking with clinician Julie Goodnight about the Certified Horsemanship Program. This is the Horse Show Live. I'm Rick Lamb, and we'll be back after these messages. Don't you dare go away. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin, 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the five very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com.
Hi, this is Isaac Hayes, and you're listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. Can you dig it?
I'm talking with Julie Goodnight at the Rocky Mountain Horse Expo in Denver. You've always amazed me in that you combine so well kind of the world of classical riding and the world of natural horsemanship, which a lot of people feel like those are kind of somewhat disconnected worlds, but of course we know they're not. But you do a good job of really bringing out how connected they are. Does this promote more classical or natural, or is it all kind of melded together?
Well, I would say that CHA is very traditional horsemanship. And one of the neat things about CHA is that we do not mandate style or technique. We only mandate that lessons are safe, fun, and educational. And so, for instance, if you... let's say you were a John Lyons certified trainer, you could come in, and that, by the way, Rick, is name brand certification. It's not the same thing as having a certification from an objective third party.
Right. That means you've purchased the training and you've survived it and graduated
and
that course.
And now have permission to use his name.
Right.
And CHA, of course, is a third party objective certifying body. But somebody that was, for instance, John Lyons trained could come in and take our certification class, and we wouldn't really be so concerned about the specific techniques they use as long as it's safe, fun, and effective. So that's a really neat thing about the program. But CHA does publish complete rider curriculums, and we have a manual. In fact, I just finished editing this manual. It's called the Composite Manual of Horsemanship, and it's four levels, English and Western and Trail. Each level has a written test and a riding test at the end of it, so it's a complete curriculum for instructors to use or students to use, and it is what I would refer to as very traditional horsemanship.
Well, it's very cool. We've got a little brochure here. I assume this is probably available to folks if they wanted to get it.
Absolutely.
That just kind of describes the educational materials offered by this. And I like the fact, because I went all through Scouts when I was a kid.
Uh-huh.
All the way up to Eagle Boy Scout. And I loved the way that was structured. It was very motivational for me because there was recognition at every level. And you kind of were drawn not only for your own benefit and your own self-improvement, but also to kind of have respect among your peers to mm-hmm. keep moving on. And you've got that, or this organization does, the certification does, in this catalog, badges to show advancement at each level. And these are almost like arm patches or something
uh-huh.
you can wear on a vest or something.
Yeah.
So I think that's one of the great things about any of the curriculums that have, or curricula, I suppose, that have levels and recognition built into them, because that's mm-hmm. using a human learning trait, isn't it?
Yes, it is. And a certain number of students are very motivated by achievement awards. And the nice thing about the CHA curriculum is it's all laid out there for you. The book contains all the skills. And at the end of each level, there is a list of skills that you have to be able to demonstrate. There's a riding test that you have to be able to ride. The first level is just up to the beginning trot. And so it's pretty simple stuff. The second level is up to beginning canter. And then the third and fourth levels are advanced horsemanship. But at the end of each level, once you demonstrate your skills and get those checked off by your instructor, and then you take the written test and the riding test, then the instructor awards you with a badge and a certificate, and you're ready to move on to the next level.
You know, I like the fact that there's this sort of marriage of the intellectual side
of horsemanship and the physical side. When I lecture now, I always talk about, to me, that is how you gain the competence to do things with horses. It's not enough to just learn about it and kind of sit back and think about it, although that part's important. And it's not enough to just go out and sit on a horse's back and kind of stumble through whatever happens, even if you do a lot of that. It's kind of like you have to put both spheres together somehow. This obviously does that.
Yes, and we talk a lot in CHA about learning the theory behind the skills. So it is not just performing a skill, but actually understanding the theory of why your horse responds to your aids or why your horse behaves in a certain manner. And so that's really important. And that's another nice thing about the book. It does contain the theoretical information as well.
Plus, you know, I think it's so important for people to understand the reasons they're doing things. One of my pet peeves is, why do you do it that way? Because that's just the way it's always
yeah.
been done.
Yeah.
That probably drives you crazy too. That answer doesn't satisfy me.
Yeah.
I want to know, why is that a better way? Because I think that misinformation gets started and kind of perpetuated by that. And the other thing is, sometimes new ideas come out of the fact that somebody asks that question, can't get a satisfactory answer, then they go out and kind of figure it out for themselves. And they may figure out an alternate way to get the same job done.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, absolutely. And we talk a lot in our certification programs about how important it is to teach the how and the why of horsemanship, not just what. And for example, you hear instructors, almost everybody that rides has been told at some time or another to put their heels down. Well, what we tell instructors is that it's not enough to tell somebody, put your heels down. You have to tell them why it's important and how they're going to do it. Because if they knew how to do it, they'd probably be doing it.
Okay, so you brought that up. Now explain. Why do we put our heels down?
Well, why you put your heels down is it's a matter of balance. And also, if you'll notice, when you raise your heels up and you stand on the ball of your foot, it changes the shapes in your muscles. Your muscles contract. And anytime you tighten a muscle, it causes a corresponding joint to lock. And so our joints, particularly our ankles and knees and hips, are the major shock absorbers we have on the horse. And so anytime you tense a muscle, you lock a corresponding joint, then you don't have shock absorbers on the horse. So it leads to bouncing.
I cannot stump you. No matter what I do, Julie always has a great answer. That's why I always love talking to you. CHAinstructors.com.
And our main website is CHA-AHSE.org. And that stands for Certified Horsemanship Association, the Association for Horsemanship Safety and Education. On there, you'll learn about CHA. You can find out how to become a member. And you don't have to be an instructor to be a member. We have a lot of just regular horse people that are members that want to support the organization. And you can also order all of our educational materials from our website as well and find out about certification clinics.
My guest has been Julie Goodnight, the official international spokesperson for the Certified Horsemanship Association. As always, Julie, thank you.
Thank you, Rick.
Still to come, Joe Camp, creator of the Benji movies, will talk about his brand new book, The Soul of a Horse, flying off the bookshelves. This is The Horse Show. I'm Rick Lamb, and we'll be back in just a moment. Stay with us. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin, 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter N, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them.
Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the five very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lambemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
Welcome back, everybody. Coming to you today from beautiful Santa Ynez, California, at Intrepid Farm, site of the Light Hands Horsemanship Clinic. Ran into a gentleman here that I've been looking forward to meeting for some time, Mr. Joe Camp. Joe, welcome to the Horse Show.
It is my pleasure. Thanks. I've been looking forward to meeting you as well.
Well, we are kindred spirits, I think, in some respects, in that we're both relatively new to horses compared to some of these people that have been doing it for 50, 60, 70 years. And we've both written books about our journeys recently, and there's a lot of parallels between those two journeys. But let's set the stage. Let's help my viewers and listeners understand really who you are, because they know you, even if they don't know that they know you. And that is because of a little dog named Benji. Tell me the Benji story.
That's correct. Yeah, I've, for the last, I guess, what now, 30, almost 35 years, have been, you know, trying to draw you and your listeners and everybody else into the heart and soul of a dog. Telling those Benji stories. There have been five movies now and a bunch of television stuff. The last movie was in 2004, Benji Off the Leash, and that dog lives with us at home. Was very mad with me when I took off for Santa Ynez here and did not take her, because she usually gets to go along. She thinks she's going on some benefit or something. And so now we've shifted somewhat and trying to draw you into the heart and soul of a horse and telling stories once again, now using the horse. And it's one that I found very fascinating, because it's the story of my wife and I is one of the stories in the book, you know, complete, totally. You know, you are an experienced person with horses compared to us. I mean, we're less than 3 years into this. And yeah.
Well, let me stop you for just a second, because I don't want to leave Benji quite yet.
Okay.
Because this is a fascinating story in itself. You're probably tired of telling it. You've told it so many times, I imagine. Benji is a real dog. This isn't some stunt dog or some, you know, group of dogs that all play the same part. Benji is a real, living, breathing dog that came into your life. How?
Well, like I say, about 35 years ago, I was had been watching a Disney show at night and seeing a little clip from Lady and the Tramp, which was one of my favorite movies as a kid. And my wife and I, while we were doing the dishes, were talking about I wonder if it'd be possible to tell a story from the dog's point of view, you know, where the people are the props, like Lady and the Tramp, but do it with real dogs. And, you know, not Rex Allen saying, and now Benji thinking, you know, that sort of thing. And we really talked it into a corner and said, you know, without dialogue, how are you going to do that? And I stayed up that night reading a book, and our little Yorkshire Terrier, whose name was Benji, was in my lap for a while and then jumped down onto the floor. And I became intrigued with the way he was reacting to a siren going off down the street or a dog barking or something, and started watching up close. And, you know, finally I was down on the floor on my hands and knees, huddled in a corner, you know, saying, oh, like, and I was afraid of him. And he's looking at me like, what in the world is the matter with you? And I went to bed that night, you know, saying, dogs do talk. They absolutely do. If you're up there close and personal and paying attention with their eyes and with their emotions, they tell you everything that you want to know about how they're feeling, what they're going to do next, what's going on in their heads. And I was getting up at that time. I was working for an advertising agency, so I'd get up and write from 4 till 6 in the mornings and was working on something. I don't know what. But the next morning, I got up and shoved everything aside and wrote the entire Benji story, which was, I mean, I write a page an hour. You know, it was an amazing experience, because I wrote this, I don't know, 8 or 9 page treatment in 2 hours. Took it in, read it to my wife as I was waking her up, and tears were coming down her eyes at the end of the thing. And I said, yes. And only 7 years later, we finally were able to produce the movie.
I was going
to
say, it wasn't received quite as you had hoped it would be.
No, the story idea was, you know, turned down by everybody in Hollywood. 4 or 5 years later, we were able to maneuver ourselves out of the advertising agency into a commercial production business, and actually go about the business a year or two after that of raising the money privately for the movie. Made what we thought was a very wonderful, heartwarming, new kind of movie, because a dog was acting on the screen for the first time ever. You know,
was it your Benji?
No, not the Yorkshire Terrier. With the name came through, but not the dog. We had to go out to Hollywood and search, and we went through trainer after trainer, you know, saying, you know, this is going to be a very unique kind of movie. And every trainer says, not possible, you can't do this. It's not, you can't do this. No, you can't turn a dog loose on a set and expect him to act natural. He's got to be looking at me and paying attention to me. And finally got to Frank Inn, who you know, is a trainer of all the animals, somebody, Beverly Hillbillies and Petticoat Junction and Green Acres, Arnold the Pig, all that stuff. And Benji, the dog that he showed me, had actually been on Petticoat Junction for, I don't know, 10, 12 years, however long it was, and was in retirement. He was 13 years old. And it was the opposite look of what I anticipated, you know, because Lady and the Tramp, Tramp is all scruffy, and Lady's all soft and pretty. And this is the way Higgins, who was his name at the time, was all soft and pretty. He wasn't, you know, short and scruffy like Tramp. But I immediately changed my thinking when I saw this dog and saw the way Frank worked with him. And Frank's attitude to the whole thing was, you know, I don't know how it'll be done, because nobody's ever done it before, but we'll give it everything we got. And that's all you can ask of anybody, you know. And so then I went back and wrote the script after casting the dog. And
was the script pretty true to your original treatment?
It was absolutely true, with two exceptions. One, the original treatment was set inner city, back alleys, and we moved it into a Victorian country town in North Texas that was a very photogenic kind of place. And the other addition was about 15 minutes when we got to the end of the movie, got it all cut, got everything done, and it was 10 or 12 minutes too short. And I had to go back and rewrite more stuff, go raise some more money to do the additional production, and it turned out to be one of the best scenes in the picture.
Obviously, you've made the transition now, focused-wise, to horses. And you've got this new book called The Soul of a Horse, Life Lessons from the Herd. Why did you jump into this at this level? I mean, so not only your own personal journey, but immediately start writing about it.
Well, I think it came out of the passion. You know, I found it, as I said earlier, you know, I'm a storyteller. You know, I'm not a historian, you know, and I don't, not terribly detailed about things, but I am a storyteller. And the deeper we got into this, you know, it all began very innocently and accidentally with a birthday gift that Kathleen gave me of a trail ride. You know, the last Benji movie, you know, which I think is one of the best ones, if not the best one we did not do as well against the Hollywood. It was independently distributed, just like the first one was, and because Hollywood had turned that one down, and you go up against the millions and millions of dollars they're spending out there now, and you know, it doesn't work as well as it did back in the 70s and the 80s. And so I was kind of depressed about, you know, it not doing as well as some of the other movies. And Kathleen tried to pull me out of it by giving me something else to think about. And wow, did she, because we went out on this trail ride and 3 weeks later we owned three horses. And I can promise you that a trail ride is not a good reason to own three horses. It doesn't, you know. And so we, you know, as I say in the book, we should have called them impulsive, compulsive, and, you know, because that it began us on a journey as complete, total idiot neophytes. We didn't have a clue of what we were supposed to be doing with these guys. It was just, you know, oh, this is great. We need to have these horses. And I'm one of those who would stop by a pasture and watch a foal, you know, frolic in the pasture. Sure. And just wish, you know, all my life. And so it's always kind of been latent there. I think most people have that latency, and some, this trail ride somehow triggered it. And as we dug through this and asking everybody that we knew who had experience, you know, what do you do? Why do you do this? What's going on? Everything we were finding out was coming back without logic, you know. And the more I dug into it, the more I began to figure that what in the world is going on in this world of horses? And it took us, you know, about a year and a half to get to that point of feeling confident enough in what we were beginning to dig through, having started with a clean plate instead of all the baggage that, right, you know, so many horse people, that's the way my daddy did it, and mm-hmm. his daddy before him, and that sort of thing. And so it got quickly beyond the natural horsemanship, you know, the training and teaching. I call it teaching now rather than training, because training, you know, kind of looks as somebody trying to dominate somebody else. But it got all the way into horse care and, you know, feet and everything else. And what I finally came down to was the fact that you know, genetically, every horse on the planet's the same, whether they're out in the wild or whether they're living in a stall. And that demands a certain kind of, you know, care and feeding and handling of these horses for their genetics alone.
My guest is Joe Camp, author of the hot new book, The Soul of a Horse, Life Lessons from the Herd. And we'll kind of focus on the life lessons part when we come back. This is The Horse Show. I'm Rick Lamb. Stay with us.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
That's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Pirelli.
And I'm Linda Pirelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD-TV.
RFD-TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
Take Pirelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other, how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD-TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
Or call 615-227-9292.
RFD-TV and Pirelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
Imagine this. Your stirrup drops 3 inches with the push of a button and locks back in place with the lift of your toe. That, my friends, is the legendary Easy Up Stirrup Extender, and it makes a huge difference in mounting your horse. Learn all about it at easyupstirrup.com. And while you're there, check out the Easy Up Stirrup Swivel. It takes the stress off your knees while riding. Easy Up Stirrup Extenders and Stirrup Swivels are available for English and Western saddles, and you can order them online at easyupstirrup.com. Come on, get out and ride again.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition.
Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need.
Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's G-R-O-strong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Jeffers is the best equine catalog with more than 25,000 items, same-day free shipping, and the lowest prices guaranteed. Jeffers has equine blankets in a wide range of sizes and weights to fit any horse from a mini to a draft. Mention the Horse Show and get a $10 Jeffers gift card to use with a future order. That's a $10 gift card when you buy a blanket and mention the Horse Show. Call 1-800-JEFFERS or visit jefferseequine.com. Jeffers Equine, earning your trust right here in America since 1975. EPM is a devastating neurologic disease that can strike anytime, anywhere. Be prepared with Protozil, the only FDA-approved top-dress EPM treatment. These alfalfa-based pellets are proven to rapidly reach therapeutic levels and are a less stressful option for you and your horse than a paste. For a limited time only, Merck Animal Health is offering a $50 Protozil rebate with proof of purchase from your veterinarian. To download the rebate, visit Protozil.com. That's Protazil.com. See website for complete product safety information. The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on 4 standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
You know how it works, folks. Word of mouth advertising, that's the best kind. We do appreciate your help. My guest is Joe Camp, author of The Soul of a Horse.
I said at the beginning that we were kind of kindred spirits in a way, because I have a similar story in that I kind of started in this industry with a clean slate, having been a city boy. My only experiences were, maybe once or twice a year, we'd go to a grandparent's place and they would, you know, one of the cousins would bring a pony along or something like that. So I didn't have to unlearn a bunch of stuff either, as you did. And then you find that we both are very fortunate in that we landed in this at a time when teaching systems are developing and talented teachers are out there that are presenting it in a way that makes sense. There's a body of education available. There's courses that you can take. There's consistency. There's a certain amount of logic to it. There are kind of rules that you can ingrain and work from. In this whole universe, you were drawn to one man in particular, Monty Roberts. Why Monty?
Well, we began there, you know, but I have every DVD that Clinton and Pirelli have done and most of their books, and I became obsessive about, I'm 69 right now. I guess I was 66 at the time, and so who knows? I don't have 40 years to, to gather all that experience. But Monty, we were making our kind of obligatory trip to Boot Barn before the horses came to get all the stuff that we needed, and Kathleen picked up a magazine or newspaper or something while we were there, and we were taking the kids out for hamburgers afterwards and just sitting there eating, and she read me this story about Monty Roberts, who I knew vaguely, and so I immediately went home and ordered his join-up DVD, which, as you know, and probably most of your listeners do, is, a 30-35 minute traipse with a brand new horse from 0 to 100 with rider and saddle and the whole thing, without any pressure, without any, cruelty or violence. And I was just astounded. And so when Cash, my guy, who's on the cover of the book, got to our place, along with the two others that we bought, the three at once. That's the first thing I did, is take him down to the round pen and try this join-up thing. And I was scared to death. And I was doing everything I could. Everybody says, keep your adrenaline down, because they read it. And so I'm sitting there. That's all I'm thinking about, is that when the time finally came, and I'm not a big fan of rejection, so I was really afraid to make that final move of saying, okay, do you accept me? Do you trust me? And giving Cash the choice, because what happens if he said no? And I finally did. And when he came over and touched me on the shoulder, I just broke down crying and lost it completely. And at that moment, everything changed from horse owner to horse companion and making the best shot I could at being horse leader.
Well, that is told so beautifully in your book, and it's just rare to find somebody who really has the art of riding. down. And I would say that Joe Camp has that. He's writing from his heart. Really good writers, to me, I'm not even aware I'm reading. It's like the ideas are just flowing into my brain. And that's the kind of writer that Joe is. And these are the kind of stories. They will absolutely touch you. And it is kind of funny because Joe and I put out the same kind of book about the same time. And both of them, mine being called Human to Horseman, both of them are kind of self-effacing in a way, because you tell about the mistakes that you made and the shortcomings that you had and the ignorance that you had entering this and what you've learned and where you've come on your journey, same as I did. It's a little bit of that compulsion to share ideas that I think we both have. But it's also cathartic in a way. It's also, when you write about this, you're processing it, you're reliving it. It's changing. It's doing something in your own brain.
I have the feeling
that's part of the reason that you were so eager to get this book in print so quickly.
Well, I've also found it's harder to do in real, in face to face with somebody. But if you can involve them emotionally, as I know you know from your writing, I can tell that when you involve them emotionally within a concept, it puts them into a position that, they're not being, preached at. They're saying, wow, this is right. This works. And we've heard this come back to us so much off of this book that, we're really moving a lot of people. And that's the goal of the book, is to move people to do better for the horse.
And of course, they see themselves in the place that you were when you first started on this journey. And they're saying, gee, there are other people out there that don't have all the answers, just like I don't have all the answers. There are other people out there that are frightened. They're worried that they're going to make a mistake. They're fearful of getting hurt. I mean, all of these are common, almost universal themes. But somebody coming into this kind of new looks around and says, well, gee, everybody else seems to know so much, and they seem to have so much experience and ride so much better, and they're not worried about getting hurt. And then you find out that really we're all the same. We all share those same concerns.
And Kathleen, of course, in this book, which I know you've gotten, you understand what she's been going through. She was scared to death on the trail ride that she gave to me, and I had no clue. I mean, we were deep into it before I realized that she was petrified of these beasts, and it's taken her quite a while. And she let herself be exposed in this book too, because I told her story as well as mine, and as well as, there's also a running story of about a wild herd that's through this thing, and they all tend to reflect each other and balance themselves in what we were learning and where we were going with it. And Kathleen now, I'm so proud to watch her out in the pasture with these guys and being a leader and, right in the middle of all of them on a cold, blustery day, and she's just absolutely comfortable.
Well, it's very, very empowering once you get past it. But I suppose the thing that I don't want people to ever do is be embarrassed about being afraid.
Right.
Because, and I like the thinking of John Lyons on this, your fear is your natural survival instinct at work. In fact, it's something to be celebrated because it means that your antenna are working correctly.
Right.
If you're feeling fear, there's a reason. Your subconscious is picking up something. You sense that you don't have control in a situation, and those are good things that you feel that way. And fear dissipates naturally when you start feeling you have more control over a situation. That comes to a great extent from just learning more about this animal.
That's right.
And starting to have some positive experiences, as you describe in your book, especially that join-up moment you described right there. I mean, that not only emotional for you, had to be tremendously empowering. Like, gee, I really can do this.
Yeah, and when you give the horse the choice, I know a lot of people laugh at this, but when you give the horse the choice rather than take that choice from him to say, I want to be with you, I trust you, everything changes. All of ours have done that, and I've got one that was, just a cathartic case. It absolutely wasn't there. And when the join-up finally happened and she knew it was her choice, and it was accepted, she was 180 degrees from what she was from that moment on. It was just, it's just fascinating to me the way it works. And we spend an enormous amount of time out in the pasture just sitting on a rock, you know, watching, letting them, you know, associate with us as they choose, and watching the way they deal with each other, and watching that language and so forth. And you learn so much. And that was why it's called Life Lessons from the Herd, really, because, you know, one of the big lessons for life for us was get over on the other side of the lead rope when you want a relationship, whether it's with you or your wife or your kids or your boss or your employees or whatever. And suddenly everything gets better when you look at it from the other perspective rather than from yours. What do you want to get out of it? Now, what are their hopes on getting out of this relationship? Then everything changes.
Yeah, that's that empathy thing at work, trying to kind of see it from the horse's point of view. And the other thing I like that you said, and I think we'll close on this today, is just this idea of kind of getting quiet and kind of just observing and thinking about what you see, spending time in the presence of horses, but not trying to affect them by your presence, just being there and watching and observing and trying to really get a sense of what their world is like. Without asking anything of them. I mean, I think that's square one. If I was to give somebody a square one on this journey, it would be just go observe. Don't jump in and immediately start trying to change horses or ride them or do anything. Just try and figure out what this beast is about.
Begin at the beginning.
That is a good bit of advice. My guest has been Joe Camp. The name of the book is The Soul of a Horse, Life Lessons from the Herd. And I suspect you have a website where they can get that. Besides, it's in every bookstore. But what website?
TheSoulOfAHorse.com.
TheSoulOfAHorse.com.
Or even if you can't remember that, Benji.com, and you can cross-link over.
All right. My guest again has been Joe Camp. Joe, thanks for being with us today.
It's my pleasure.
And there you have it, my friends. Now, wasn't that an interesting hour? Joe Camp and Julie Goodnight, both excellent communicators about horsemanship. And I think that's a huge thing. I mean, it's one thing if you're a great horseman, and that's good for you, that's good for your horse, all of that. But it's something altogether different if you can elevate the whole subject through the way you communicate it with other people. And that's why I think that these clinicians that we have today, who get some flack, unfortunately, from people that I think just don't see the picture correctly, that they're not presenting anything new, that it's kind of stuff that's been around for a long time. I think the ability to see something with fresh eyes and express it in a unique way and spread the word about it is very, very valuable. And so I hope that I'm one of them. And I never claim to have invented anything. I think I've come up with a few original ideas, but mainly it's just trying to help everybody else share in the knowledge that I've gained along the way from the great teachers that I've had the chance to study with. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Lamb.